right, let's see. Let me start here. Worry and fear. All right. Many of us view worry and fear as acceptable sins, or at least something that at best just you manage. We have a lot of people out on the street on meds for anxiety meds, right? There are a lot of people in our culture taking anxiety meds because they just, that's a normal part of life anymore, and they just are trying to deal with that. But it is a sin, and we'll talk about that in a minute. It literally means a divided mind. It's two Greek words put together, which are merimneo, and, well, merimneo is the Greek word. Meritzo means to divide, and nous means mind, so it means a divided mind. So, like, you're not all there, right? So when you're worried, are you all there? Are you able to concentrate? No, you are not all there. All right, and it is forbidden in God's word. Does anyone want to argue with that? It really is. When I found out as a young believer, when I found out that we are commanded not to worry and that worry is a sin, I was floored. I thought, wow, okay, I need to get a grip on this. It is sin. It's forbidden. And you can see, I don't know, let's see, do I have a copy of your notes? Do you have all these verses, like Matthew 6? Okay, does somebody want to grab Matthew 6 for us and read Matthew 6, 25? Who has Matthew 6, 25? Okay, go ahead.
Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes?
Yeah, and then someone get Matthew 6, 31. Crystal.
So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?
All right, and how about somebody get Matthew 6, 34? All right.
So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble.
So he's repeated this. Jesus, this is Jesus speaking, and he's repeated it several times. He's making a point, and I hope we get it, right? God does not want us to worry. And I love this passage in Matthew 6, and I would encourage you to memorize it if you have trouble with worry. And we'll talk more about, we'll kind of take it apart and look at some more of it in a little bit. All right, and then Philippians 4:6 says, be anxious for nothing. There it is again. So I think we've pretty much would all agree that worry is a sin. Worry is an over-anxious concern regarding the future and things that keep a person from fulfilling current biblical responsibility. An over-anxious concern regarding the future and things. Future and things. It keeps a person. In the Oxford Dictionary, the definition of worry is to feel anxious or troubled about actual or potential problems. And now, lest you think, okay, I don't worry. Pastor Byers taught some on worry a few years ago, and he said, everybody worries. And I know people who I've talked to said, well, I don't worry. But you need to think about stress. When you say I'm stressed, I feel pressured, I have nervous tension, all those are worry, very often worry. So, and then we have fear. So we're doing worry and fear. Fear's kind of like the worry on steroids, right? Fear, and this would be sinful fear. Defined here. A powerful and often habitual focus on perceived danger or loss that prevents us from properly loving God and others. That is sinful fear, and we're going to talk about an appropriate fear in a few minutes. But this is going to help you evaluate, are my fears rational? Are they biblical? Are they okay? Right? Okay, it has a source other than God. And 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind or self-discipline." And it can take many forms from the world's perspective. And you've got your list there on your notes, all the phobias. Does anybody here say it? I've got that phobia. Has anybody watched the movie Arachnophobia? Yeah. Yeah. That is a hoot. If you've never watched it, you should watch it. It's really funny, but not if you don't like spiders. But you know what? I Googled phobias, and there are over at 500 different types of phobias. So, I mean, people are fearful, right? How about the chlorophobia, the fear of clowns? Crystal's nodding. She's like, oh, yeah, okay. Electrophobia, fear of chickens. Claustrophobia, anybody do that? Oh. You know what? One time, I'll just tell you a brief story. We homeschool, and so one time we took our kids to Southern Indiana, and we were part of a group who were going to spend the night in a cave. And so we hiked into the cave, and we, you know, laid out our Visqueen and put our sleeping bags down. And then they took us on a hike in deeper into the cave. And so we had our helmets with our lights and stuff. And at one point, we're crawling, doing an army crawl through this. It couldn't have been more than 18 inches high, this channel, this cavern. And I hear somebody say, I hear somebody start to get claustrophobic, and I say, we can't go backwards. You could, I mean, it would have been very hard to go backwards. You were pretty much stuck going forwards. Yeah. And then I start thinking, I mean, this just thing has to shift just a few inches and we're all squished. You know, I start thinking that way. And I had to just discipline my mind to stop and breathe and to think, no, God's with me. God is here. Just breathe. This guy in front of me who's scared, the man in front of me was freaking out a little bit. He'll be okay. Yeah, and he was a bigger man, so I think he was a little bit nervous about getting stuck. It was... Yeah, it convinced me that, you know, spelunking wasn't my thing. I thought I tried it, and then sleeping on bat dung. Anyway, that was a one-time event. But yeah, I mean, these can be real, right? You can be in situations like that, and we're going to talk about how you control that and you get your thoughts. And that's why, our train, you know, with thinking truth. Thinking truth is so important because your emotions can just start to try to run the train. Okay, many forms. There are some of them. Clustered around three key themes in Scripture. So God doesn't list all these phobias in the Bible, right? We can pretty much find these themes in Scripture. And the three of them are the fear of man. And Proverbs 29:25 says, "The fear of man will bring a snare, but he who trusts in the Lord will be exalted." Anybody here have the fear of man? What do I mean, fear of man? What is that? Crystal.
You can be more afraid of what people think of you, or, you know, what people can do, and more afraid of them than God. Like, you put them on airplane
with God. Yes. You put people above the Lord, and you're more fearful of them than you are of God. And you want people to like you, approve of you, and all that. Fear of man. Right? The Pharisees had that. And then we have, you know what? Let's pull out John 12, 42 and 43. Somebody read that, because this is a very real, all of us has been here. I don't think anybody in this room could say, I've never had any fear of man. I mean, I'd be surprised. We do care about what other people think about us, and to some degrees more than others. What does John 12, 42 and 43 say? Sarah.
"Nevertheless, many even of the rulers believed in him, but because the Pharisees, they were not confessing him for fear that they would be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the approval of men rather than the approval of God."
Right. The Pharisees were fearful that they would be put out of the synagogue, and they loved the approval of men more than the approval of God. I think we've probably all been there, unfortunately. Okay, and then the fear of losing temporal things. Pull out your Bibles and look at Matthew 6. And I'm just going to read through Matthew 6. And I'm going to start in verse 24. Because that's really, this connects. And I'm not going to read the whole of 6, but in verse 24, no one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? And who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Okay, so we've all been, I would say it's a rare person who hasn't had a fear of losing things, whether it's losing a job or, you know, can even be losing your house. Yeah. Losing things in a tornado or flood or fire, right? How about a fear of circumstances that you cannot change? Proverbs 3:25 says, have no fear of sudden disaster, of the ruin that can overtake the wicked. And then in Genesis 4, sinful worry began in Genesis 4 after Adam and Eve had to leave the Garden of Eden. And then they have Cain and Abel, and of course we know what happens there. Cain kills Abel, and then he says, he whines basically and says, my punishment, this isn't fair. My punishment is too much to bear. And he says, behold, you have driven me this day from the face of the ground, and from your face, he's talking to God, from your face I will be hidden, and I will be a vagrant and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. He had just committed murder, and then he is upset that someone might kill him. Isn't that ironic? And he's fearful. So sinful worry began early in the Bible. Now what's not included in this is appropriate care and concern. And if you look in your Bibles, you have a passage, Matthew 23:37-38, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. And this is Jesus speaking. Behold, your house is being left to you desolate. He cares about Jerusalem. He's saying this is not good. And then in Exodus 22:25, when the Israelites were enslaved in Egypt, God says several times in Exodus chapter 2, he saw them and he's concerned. He sees them and he's concerned. So if God can be concerned, it must be holy and righteous, right? There is an appropriate care and concern. It's focused on others, and we tend to be pretty self-focused. Okay, proper planning that acknowledges God's sovereignty. Okay, so this is to say, okay, I'm not going to worry. How many of you have seen The Lion King? And you know that song, Hakuna Matata? You know, hey, Hakuna Matata, just whatever. We're just going to live whatever we want, however we want. That's not biblical, right? No. And you have some verses there, Proverbs 6:6-8. Go to the ant. O sluggard, observe her ways and be wise, which having no chief officer or ruler prepares her food in the summer and gathers her provision and harvest. And God expects us to plan and prepare, right? And in James 4, 15 through 16, it says, in James 4, these people are making plans and they'll say, okay, we're going to go to this city and that city and we're going to spend a year there and make money and we got these big plans. And God says, whoa. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we'll live and do this or that. So he's not saying don't plan, right? He's saying put God in your plans. Say, okay, I'm going to plan to go to this city and make money and do this or that, but I'm going to pray and ask God to help me and seek to follow God's principles, right? And that flies in the face of some religious groups, some Christians who would just, you know, maybe flip open their Bible and say, you know, I'm not going to plan, I'm not going to save, but I know God wants me to move to Alaska. And, you know, that flies in the face of Scripture because God does want us to plan and prepare. And he expects us to do that. We just need to lay our plans out before him. And a key, ladies, I'm just going to tell you, a key here is the two greatest commandments. And what are the two? What's the greatest commandment? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And what's the second? Love others. And that's a great check for, like, is my fear okay? Is my concern okay? Am I loving God and loving others? All right. And God, what's not included in this sinful fear is the fear of God. This is something we're commanded to do, to fear the Lord. Okay, so who wants to define the fear of the Lord? Or take a stab at it, just a few. You don't have to have this full-orbed Webster's dictionary definition, but what is the fear of the Lord?
Respect.
That's a good word. That's a synonym. What else? Anybody else?
Devotion.
Respect, devotion.
Awe,
reverence. Yeah. I've got a quote here from John Piper that I'm going to read you that he describes, how he describes the fear of God. He says, the fear of God is as if you were caught in a terrible storm while exploring an Arctic glacier. Okay, so you're up there in the Arctic exploring a glacier and this incredible storm comes. Snow, wind, howling, just, yeah, crazy. The storm is so strong that you fear that you'll be blown right over the side of the glacier. But then you discover a cleft in the ice where you can hide and find shelter. And even though you're safe, you watch the storm go past with a kind of trembling, fearful pleasure. At first, you may be fearful that the storm might claim your life. But then you find refuge and you gained hope that you would be safe. But not everything in the feeling called fear vanished from your heart, only the life-threatening part. There remained the trembling, the awe, the wonder, the feeling that you would never want to tangle with such a storm or be an adversary to such power. The fear of God is what is left of the storm when you have a safe place to watch right in the middle of it. Oh, the thrill of being there in the center of the awful power of God, yet protected by God himself. And something that's essential in understanding the fear of the Lord is his holiness and his wrath. And that storm kind of pictures in your mind his power. And all of those things should be things that we think about. Somebody find Mark 4. If you have your Bibles, let's all turn to Mark 4, verses 36 through 41. Mark 4. 36 through 41. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was, Jesus, in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up and waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, peacefully sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the waves died down, and it was completely, totally calm like glass. And he said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? And what's their response? They are scared out of their wits. They are really, they're terrified. And they say, whoa, this guy talks to the wind. And it does what he says and the waves. And I want you to notice that when he healed somebody, did they have that same response? No, they didn't. They weren't terrified when he healed somebody, were they? But when he calms the storm, isn't that interesting? When he calms the storm and they see his power, I mean, it's all displaying his power. But they weren't invested. When he healed the leopard, leper, and he heals the blind man, the disciples are like objective observers. They're not invested. These are, you know, they're just watching what Jesus did. Were they invested here? Their own lives were in danger. They thought they were all going to die. And when that happened, when Jesus calmed the storm, it was like for the first time they like really recognized his power. And so God wants us, that's a good thing, to be terrified like that is good, because it's recognizing the power of God. Does that make sense? Okay, all right. So the fear of the Lord is also the beginning of wisdom, right? In Proverbs 1:7. And Ecclesiastes 12 says, when the conclusion has all been heard, fear God and keep his commandments, because this applies to every person. So I hope you have room in your thoughts about God for fearing him appropriately, because that's good. That's good. And another thing that is not included in these definitions is, and we were talking about the sinful anger in the previous section, but another thing that's not included in sinful anger is respect for danger. God gave you, I mean, you are going to have dangerous times, right? When you cross the street and a dump truck is accelerating towards you, you should have some fear, right? But what happens? Your fear moves you to do something, right? Your fear moves you to do something. And that's what God wants you to do. He gave you that, the fight or flight. Everybody's heard those buzzwords, you know, tendencies. God gave you that because that is a way of protection and self-protection. So there is a right respect for danger that would cause you to move and save your life. All right, God cares about our struggle. He wants us to bring him into the picture. And his messengers frequently sought to calm the fears of the people. Someone read for us 2 Kings 1:15. And then someone else look up Luke 12:7. When you have 2 Kings 1:15, who has that? Anybody? Okay, thank you, Leslie. And Luke 12, verse 7. Go ahead, Leslie.
Then the angel of the Lord said to Elijah, go down with him. Do not be afraid of him. And he arose and went down and finished with him.
Okay, this is God talking to Elijah, and there's a king who wants to kill him. And that seemed to be his whole life story. Kings wanted to kill him. Ahab, and now this one's Ahaziah, and they just don't like him because he speaks truth and they don't like what he tells them. And so he sends these guards to go capture him, and he's like, no, I'm not coming. And they go through these series of being torched, really. The guys who try to go up the mountain, he calls down fire and they get consumed. Finally, the captain, the third captain who sent, these other two captains and all their men have died in fire because they tried to capture Elijah and God wouldn't let them. So the third captain comes up to Elijah and he goes, please have mercy. I worship God. Would you please have mercy on me and my men? And will you please come with me to go meet King Ahaziah? And this is when the angel of the Lord speaks to Elijah and says, don't worry, go with him. So he's walking into a very dangerous situation. And God said, no, you need to do that. And God may call us into dangerous situations. How about Luke 12:7? Yeah, go ahead.
Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Do not fear, you are more valuable than many sparrows.
Yeah, God says you are more valuable than many sparrows, and you don't worry. The hairs of your head are all numbered. And in Luke 1:30, the angel says to Mary, do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God. God doesn't want us to be fearful. And flip over to Luke 1:74. This is a beautiful passage. Luke 1:7, and these verses in 67 through 79 are Zechariah, who is John the Baptist's father. This is his burst of praise to the Lord when he can finally speak again. And verse 74, he's talking about why Jesus is coming. And he said, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness all our days. Isn't that beautiful? God wants us to serve him without fear. So God talks about this a lot. And if you read the Gospels, you see over and over Jesus saying, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Right? Have faith. So, okay, Susan, how do I do that? All right, don't worry. We're going to talk about it. Okay, Jesus, and then we said, peace. Jesus said in John 14, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. All right, so now we're going to talk about what worry and fear reveal about our hearts. All right, they tell us about your view of God. Fear is sinful when it attributes to God characteristics that are inconsistent with his nature. And that's a quote from Lou Piriolo. And he's one of the resources I think we list at the end of your notes. But you don't trust someone you don't know. Isn't that right? You don't trust someone you don't know. If you don't know God very well, my guess is you don't trust him very much. So I want you, one of the keys, if not the most important key, to not fearing and not having sinful worry is to get to know God better. And if you've been in my class before, you've seen my 3x5 cards, and I list the attributes of God on them. I go A through Z, A, B, C, D, E. I have these cards, and I'll hand them around, you can look at them. And I put an A for an attribute, like A, almighty, all-knowing. This one I have alive, because I started around Easter to make that deck, and it just was appropriate. And I use these to meditate on who God is. And I'll write down a Webster's definition to help me, and synonyms, because that just helps me to get my brain around what is almighty. So I'll just, you know, talking to my smartphone and say, definition of almighty. And it'll come back and it'll give me some synonyms. And I'll write those on the card because that helps me to think about what it means for God to be almighty. And then underneath that, I will look, you can look in your concordance and find a verse about God being almighty or God being compassionate.
This is a drill. Please initiate severe weather protocol. This is a drill. Please initiate severe weather protocol.
Okay, so we're going to carry on, because if it's not a drill, then we'll do it. Okay, so I make these cards and I go A through Z, and they're just an excellent way to meditate on who God is and his character. I think that's like my fourth or fifth deck that I make, and then I give them away, because they can help somebody who's in need, who maybe doesn't have the time to think through that and write all those verses down. So I give them to somebody who's in the hospital or grieving. So anyway, that is a great way that I really got to know God better. Another, memorizing scripture. And I use the scriptures on those cards, but memorizing scripture is another way to get to know the Lord better. Jeremiah 9:23 says, let not the wise man boast in his riches, right? Anybody know that one? I should have it memorized, but I don't. Maybe I'll put that on my list for the next time. He says, God says in Jeremiah 9:23, let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, or the rich man boast of his riches, but let him who boasts boast about this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on the earth, for in these I delight. So God wants us to be boasting that we know him. Jeremiah 9:23 and 24. Okay, so now we have this list here of things, and I want you to do a self-evaluation. As we click through these, and I'm going to be telling you what your fill in the blank is, I want you to evaluate yourself on a scale of 0 to 10, with 0 being, I'm really rotten at this, and 10 being, whoa, perfection! Okay. So, all right, here we go. Do you believe that he can be trusted? Trusted. Do you trust God? And rate yourself. You don't look at what your neighbor.
Believe it or do it.
What?
Believe it or do it.
Do it. Do you actually act like you trust God? I mean, this is not Sunday school answers. Jesus, God, the Bible. Okay? This is you in your daily life and in your distress when you're worried and afraid. Do you believe he can be trusted? 0 to 10. Do you believe he loves you? And this is so good. Evaluate yourself. Be very honest, because this will help you pinpoint what things you need to work on to overcome the worry, right? Do you believe he loves you? Do you really believe he has a specific plan for you? Or do you think he's forgotten you and you're just a cog on the wheel? Where are you on a scale of 0 to 10? Do you really believe he is powerful? Or do you think he's just kind of helpless? There are things he just can't do or are out of his control. Do you believe he is sovereign? Do you believe he plans things, all things, and he allows them to happen? Like Psalm 139 says, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Do you believe that is true, that he's planned every day you've lived? Scale of 1 to 10, or 0. I hope nobody's a 0. Okay, do you really believe he is a good king? You may believe he's sovereign, but do you believe he's good? And how would you rate yourself? What does your fear and worry say about your working theology? And I would encourage you to be honest with yourselves, and if you need some help with your own practical theology on his love or on any one of these, the Gospel Primer is a great source. If you've heard of it, by Milton Vincent, it's down in our resource center. It's not expensive. The Gospel Primer, that's excellent. Or you could read Elise Fitzpatrick's book, Because He Loves Me. Or you could read A.W. Tozer, Attributes of God. Just some of these suggestions. All right, now ladies, I want to tell you something that when I understood this, when God showed me this truth, it really helped me to work harder at not worrying and see the seriousness of my sinful worry. Here it is. Do you understand that your worry is an insult to God? It is a slap in the face to Jesus Christ. Because you are saying that he's a liar, that he's not good, and that he doesn't keep his promises. When I really came to grips with that, it helped me to understand how wicked my worry was. And here's another revelation. You are not God. Sometimes our worry reflects the reality that we think we could do a better job than God at orchestrating our lives or orchestrating someone else's life. And what does the Bible call that? When we think we could do a better job. Well, why doesn't God do this? And he ought to do that. What would the Bible call that? Pride. Bingo. Thinking you could do a better job than God? Really? That's just staggering. Okay, so now we're getting into the nitty-gritty here. It's revealing your heart, and as we said, it reveals what your practical theology is about God, and it also reveals your theology of you, your view of you. And this is every bit as important. Do you view yourself as one of God's forgiven children? That you really are his child, that he's really your father. 0 to 10, where would you put yourself? Do you view yourself that way? Think carefully. Do you believe that nothing can separate you from his love? Or do you feel like he turns his back on you? Put your rating down. Are you glad to be one of his servants? Do you want to be a servant? Do you want to be his slave? Is your life about God furthering your plan or you furthering his plan? And is your worry and fear because you have a plan and it's not happening? Are you willing to endure trials if that is the means God wishes to use to conform you to the image of his Son and glorify himself? You might be in a severe trial right now. Are you willing to let God use this to change you? And are you fighting it and hating it? Give yourself a rating there. And finally, what does your worry and fear say about your view of yourself? And I just want to push the proverbial pause button that I always do. And I want you to think about one aspect of fear. Like I would struggle with fear of the future. I would struggle with fear. Like when my husband became self-employed and left a corporate job, that was a fearful thing for me because I found out that I was trusting in this corporate paycheck and not in God. And that was good. That was good for me to come to grips with that. And so I had some fear of the future to deal with. And I had to realize, come to terms with the fact that I was imagining a future without God. And I've had some cancer removed from my body, and I've had some other things happen, and I have a fractured vertebrae, you know, so I can have fear about my health and fear about what's going to happen. And I found that when I was gripped with fear, it was because I was imagining a future without God. I was not imagining His grace supplying all my needs. I was not imagining Him meeting all of my needs according to His riches and glory. I was not imagining Him being glorified as He gave me grace to endure pain or physical calamity. And once I realized that, it's like, whoa, I am imagining a godless future. And that is why I'm so afraid. And that helped me a lot to realize to instead put God into my future and think, wait, He's taken care of me in the past. He's always come through. I've watched Him take care of other people. I've watched people be victorious in trials. He promises to do that for me. Why should I worry about cancer? Why should I worry about, you know, financial ruin? I have Jesus. He can never be taken away from me. And you know that song that we sing in church? Hallelujah, all I have is Christ. I love that song because I know that if I lose everything, I have Jesus. I can't lose everything. I have Jesus. No one can ever take away my best friend, the one I love more than anything else. I have Jesus. So I would encourage you to love Him and get to know Him and help foster that by your time in the Word and some of the things that I've told you. Okay, we're going to move along here. How about your view of other people? The Psalm 27 says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?" David said in Psalm 56, "When I am afraid, I'll trust in you." Was David, did he have reason to be fearful? Why? Somebody tell me. Yeah, he had the guy in charge of the country wanting to kill him. And he had an whole army of people trying to help him kill David and find him. He was hiding. He had to run for his life. And you remember in part of, is it 1 Kings, 2 Kings, where Saul's chasing David with his army and they're on the same mountain. They're on the same mountain and David and his men are running down one side of the mountain and on the other side of the mountain are Saul and his men. And it's like, that's a movie script. I mean, right? I mean, that is crazy. They're on that very same mountain, and if one of them crosses over, they're going to... But he had every reason in the world to be afraid, but he trusted. He said, "When I'm afraid, I will trust in you." So are you afraid of what people are going to do to you or do for you? Afraid of them not doing something for you or to you? You know, that's what that happens when we get to be the center of our universe and we want what we want, right? And I know, I've got to tell you, ladies, if your view of this life is like, this life, I've got to go for the gusto, I've got to get everything I can out of this life, and I don't like it that I didn't get this kind of degree and that I'm not earning this kind of money and that my husband doesn't have this kind of job and that we don't have this kind of house, if that is your focus and you're all about this world, then good luck. You're going to worry. Because God never intended you to be focused like that. He wants you to set your heart on things above, not on earthly things. So, and another cure to worry is to have a very heavenly focus, to have an eternal focus, to have a very robust view of eternity and heaven. And now, ladies, you know, if you've taken my classes before, you know, I like to say the Bible starts with a perfect earth and it ends with a perfect earth, right? And in the end, in Revelation, when Jesus comes back, God is going to take heaven and earth. And it says you know, in Revelation 21, I saw the heavenly Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, and heaven and earth are going to be married together. They're not going to be separate places. And God will walk with us on earth, and earth is going to be like remade, and it is going to be fantabulous. I mean, what we see now in some of the most beautiful photographs that we see of gorgeous places, you know, the beaches and the Fiji Islands and the mountains and all the beautiful things you see, those are sin-cursed. They're not even close to as beautiful as it's going to be when Jesus remakes this earth. And do you think you're going to experience some of the awesome things that God has for you? Or do you think it's going to be this boring existence of just, you know, standing in this big choir singing the same song over and over? No, I hope you understand that God is very creative. If you look at the universe, you see his vastness in the planets and the incredible universe, and you see his incredible creativity and love of beauty in creation. And we're going to enjoy all that. If you know that you know that you know that you're on your way to heaven, then you will have an incredible future to look forward to. Incredible. But if you insist on wanting all that stuff now, and you want this life in this sin-cursed world to be the way you want it to be, I promise you, you're going to have trouble. So I would just encourage you to, I love Randy Alcorn's book, Heaven. And he helps you see, you know, this life's a vapor. This life's like over, like, poof, right? And then there's eternity and relationships. Sinless, no problems. Won't that be fabulous? And Jesus, you know, you'll get to go sit down and eat tacos with Jesus. It'll be awesome. It will be so neat. And that, you know, some of the most fabulous vacations that you can imagine are nothing like what it's going to be. But we get so glued to this life and wanting what we want, that these things, like our view of other people and them doing or not doing what we want, and our little kingdom not turning out the way we want, becomes consuming. And then we're just a worried, frazzled mess, right? All right. That was all free of charge. Okay. This is a more of overcoming worry. Jesus has no interest, this is a quote from David Powlison's Worry book. Jesus has no interest in simply talking about what's wrong with us. He's always going somewhere good. He does make reference to our temptation and failures, but he's more concerned with giving you a solid reason not to worry. Yes, you may have a reason to worry because things are uncertain, right? Who knows what tomorrow will hold? But you have many, many, many better reasons not to worry. All right, so distinguish. Wait a minute, where are we? We're concerned. I'm sorry, this does not match my notes. So I am going to follow the PowerPoint. Does the PowerPoint follow your notes?
Yeah.
Okay, distinguish between right concern, appropriate fear, and sinful worry and fear. And that is, again, asking yourselves the greatest commandments. Am I loving God? Am I focused on loving God, and am I focusing on loving others? That is going to help you sort out if your worry is sinful or not. Then carefully list your feelings, thoughts, desires, words, and actions that fit under these categories, and begin to analyze them in light of God's word. The list we just went through, where I had you rate how you did. Go back and look at that tonight when you get home and say, okay, that's an area I need to work on. I can remember a few years back, I knew God was sovereign. I knew he was good, but I really didn't think he loved me personally. And that was something I didn't really grasp as well as I should have. And I knew that. So I spent a whole year studying God's love and studying his relationship with me. And that was so good. So don't just evaluate yourself and do nothing. Do something with that information and grow. All right. Confess and repent. Yes, 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 yes. Too often, ladies, we think, oh, I'm so, you know, I worried. That's wrong. And you try to go on. I'm not going to worry about that. Okay, God, you want me to trust you? Okay, I'll trust you. And what do we leave out? We leave out the repentance. We leave out saying, Jesus, I sinned against you. I've insulted your character. I've defamed your character, Lord, in my mind by sinfully believing that you're not good, you're not in control, and that's why I'm worrying. Please forgive me. Make a habit of being thorough in your repentance and thinking it. You know, it's so easy as you're running through your day and you're going through life to just flit through repentance. That's not going to help you. All right, acknowledge the temporal nature, and that's what I was just talking about with focusing on heaven. And once you, like I read Randy Alcorn's book, Heaven, and it's kind of a fat book. If you're not a reader, there's a pamphlet or a booklet in the MRC that's shorter that might help jumpstart you in thinking about heaven. It revolutionized my life. That was one of the books that I've read that really did alter my view of life, because it helped me see so much that what happens here and now is not as important as I thought it was, except people making decisions for salvation, right? That is important. But reading that book on heaven was very helpful to me. Reflect on the faithfulness of God. And I can remember a time a few years ago where Pastor Byers had told everybody, write down how God's been faithful to you. Write down some of the ways he's answered your prayers and he's shown himself faithful. If you're struggling with seeing that is an excellent, excellent exercise. And rejoice in your identity in Christ. And again, Elise Fitzpatrick's book, there's a lot out there now about your identity in Christ and that your life is hidden with Christ and God. But just let me say, that's not going to help you a whole lot, again, if you have a very temporal, earthly focus. Your identity in Christ will help you if you have an eternal focus. And if you realize, ladies, part of getting that eternal focus is realizing that Jesus has already taken care of your biggest problem, which is, ticket out of hell. Right? He paid for your sin and you don't have to go to hell. And if you don't have a very accurate view of hell, then you're not going to appreciate that very much. So let's just talk for a minute about what hell's like. What do you know about hell?
Separation from God.
Okay. Separation from God. Utter darkness, right. The Bible describes it as utter darkness. Anybody else? Weeping, constant crying, constant, you know, gritting your teeth. You grit your teeth when you're in pain. Yeah, constant torment. Yeah. The absence of anything good. Nothing good. That means like utter hatred. Utter abuse. You think of how horrible sexual abuse and some of the abuse are. Utter abuse for eternity. Abuse for eternity. Agony. Agony, like you're in a fire. The Bible describes it as a lake of fire. Like, have you been burned? Do you know how much that hurts? Burning forever. Forever. There is no way out. It never, ever ends, ever. And it's real, right? It is real because God says so. And Jesus said, don't be afraid of those in Mark 10. Don't be afraid of those who can destroy the body, but after that do no more. I remember when I first read that, destroy the body, and after that do no more. I was like, what? That sounds horrible. Somebody would mutilate me and then I'm not supposed to be afraid. But then what does he go on and say? But be afraid of the one, he's talking about his God, right? But be afraid of the one who can destroy both body and soul in hell. And you know, your body goes to hell. Our bodies, if you're a believer, will be resurrected and will be on the new earth. A person who rejects Christ will be in a bodily form in hell, in agony. Isn't that staggering? I hope that moves you to love Jesus for what he's rescued you from. And I hope that moves you to tell others that they need to follow Christ. And that will help you get more of an eternal view. Learn to draw near to our sympathetic Savior to find grace and help. Recognize the wasteful nature of fear and worry. How do worry and fear waste things? What do worry and fear waste?
Energy.
Yeah, tell me more. Time, energy. What happens when you worry? Do you go through your tasks and get everything done with great accomplishment? No. You might be half there, like we talked in the first page. You have a divided mind. What else? You might spend your energy doing something really foolish, right? Like, there are people who store up lots of food. You might use a lot of your resources doing something very foolish. There are people who are very fearful of the end times, who store a year's worth of food. And I'm not saying that that would be a horrible thing to do, but I think they're not really thinking, oh, I can't wait to share that with others. Right? They're thinking us for no more. So that's wrong. That's hoarding. But, you know, there are people who spend a lot of money and energy worrying about that. And that's wasteful. It's wrong. People who worry about, you know, fear of cancer and instead of, you know, just waiting for the biopsy result and getting busy and doing something, they close themselves off in their room and don't want to talk to anybody, and right? And we can worry about your kids, worry about your car breaking down. Let's pray. Yeah, I can waste a lot of time. Okay, develop a faithful prayer life. Yes, that includes thanksgiving, like Philippians 4. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, right? And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So you develop a prayer life that where you thank God. Do you have a habit of thanking God every day for what he's done, for what he's provided? Thankful. A thankful heart. A prayer life that's specific. Do you talk to God like he's your best friend and take the time to really talk to him? Single-tasking, not multitasking. Multitasking prayer is fine. We're supposed to pray always, right? So you also be mindful of God. Pray in the car, pray in the shower, pray while you drive, you know, all that. But if you're not single-tasking praying, you are missing the boat big time. You need to spend time, just you and God, talking to him. And you will be amazed at how your prayer life will change if you do that. If you just take the time to talk to the Lord. And I would encourage you, you know, you think, I don't know how I'm going to get that, Susan. Carve it out. You know, even if it's before you go to bed at night, go close yourself in a closet and just talk to God and your family. Don't let them know where you are. I go down where our furnace is so I can just talk to God. And the fan runs all the time at our house because we need to circulate our air. And so nobody can hear me. I'm talking to God down there next to my furnace. find a place, find a prayer closet. But I would also encourage you, too, if you're saying, wow, my schedule just looks so packed. What about Saturday? What about Sunday afternoon? What about grabbing your Bible and a hymnal and your prayer notebook and going to a quiet place away from your home? If your home is just like such a distraction to you that you're always thinking of the next thing to do, grab your stuff. Just this week, I was out running errands on Saturday morning and I stopped at Starbucks and I just sat in there because I knew I wasn't going to be interrupted, and I could just sit and read God's word. That wasn't a great place to pray, but it was a good place to just read God's word and talk to him a little bit up here. But seek those times. Seek those times. You won't ever regret it. I've never met anyone in their 80s who's got a foot in the grave who says, I really wish I hadn't prayed as much. I really wish I hadn't read my Bible so much. I really wish I hadn't spent time with the Lord. But what do you hear? You might hear the opposite. Mm-hmm. And the people, then they face death and they really don't know God. Right? So please, please develop a prayer life. Focus on fulfilling today's responsibilities today. Matthew 6, 34, after he says in Matthew 6, 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. He says, do not worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow's got enough trouble of its own. Tomorrow's going to worry about itself. So that's one of the principles of overcoming worry, is do today what you need to do. I have a sign that my daughter made for me that says, do the next thing. It has a laundry basket with laundry all over it. And she did, it's a watercolor. It's really cute. I'll have to send it to you. But it's just do the next thing. Don't get stuck worrying. Don't get stuck fretting. Just overcome by being faithful to what God's called you to do today. And in fact, I was just talking to my oldest daughter today. She's the one who did the watercolor. And she's in the hospital right now. She has ulcerative colitis, and this is her fifth day in the hospital. She has enough, and they're not releasing her tomorrow. She's very sick, and she found out today that her insurance will only cover $100,000 of her hospital stay. Well, she's been in there 5 days. She's had like 4 or 5 doctors consulting. She's been on all kinds of drugs and had lots of tests run. I expect that's over $100,000, and she's not out yet. And she told me that today, and she said, yeah, we just found out today that our insurance only covers $100,000 for a hospital stay. But she said, I don't have a bill in my mailbox today. I said, yes, that's right. So we're not going to worry about it. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it. And that was, she was applying that principle. She said, I don't have a bill yet, so I'm just going to pray and then take care of what needs to happen today. Practice loving God and others instead of focusing on what you might lose. And that's, again, another key that we talked about. Those, the first two commandments that God has laid out for us, they simplify so much, and they help you weed through so many problems where you think, I don't know what to do. Okay, how are you loving God? How are you loving others? It really, really is incredibly evaluative. And that was the end. Okay. Do you want to go through it again? No, I'm kidding. Don't worry. Okay, so ladies, are there any questions, thoughts, comments? Yes, Teresa. The quote I read you about the fear of God, the John Piper book was, let me find it. That was from The Pleasures of God. That's the title. And John Piper is a great author, too, for gaining a good view of God, an accurate view of his character. Yeah. Anybody else? Anybody want to share about a fearful time where God has really helped you? Or maybe you've applied some of these principles and God has seen you through some of this, or? Okay, so we want to have prayer for everybody as you go through this. Okay, any other questions? I mean, I want this to be very practical for you. I want you to be able to come away from this with things that you can get your brain around that say, okay, the next time I am fearful and gripped with worry, I can start doing this, or even now, I can start doing some things that are going to help me with worry and fear. I hope that that's what we've accomplished. And I don't have a worry and fear diagram. But you'll still have another chance next week. Next week, we're going to talk about depression. A biggie. Yes, and that, like I said, there's a lot of people on these psychotropic drugs for anxiety meds, and for depression. There's a lot of people in our society struggling with these things. So we want to help you see what God has to say. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you so much that your word has these answers. Thank you so much for just saving us from hell. Help us to realize and just remember what you have done for us, and that you have solved our biggest problem. And I pray that that would be very real to us. And I pray that heaven would be very real to us, and that you would help us to develop a heavenly mindset that looks forward to an incredible eternity that you've purchased for us with your blood. Lord Jesus, help us to not insult you with worrying and fearing, but help us instead to honor you by trusting in you and believing that your promises are true and that you are who you say you are. I thank you for all these ladies, and I pray that they would be encouraged and that you would be glorified in their lives. Amen.